On dit d'un bon...
It's been said of a good meal that you leave the table and you're still hungry. And I think the debate we've just witnessed and the questions which have been raised, which of course cannot be answered in one single line, even in one single paragraph, and not even in one single life. Those answers can't be given straight away, but I think that these questions have been raised here this evening, the fact that you've discussed them, debated them, the four of you, although perhaps initially you had slightly different viewpoints to start with. And why not? Because men and women of culture have, of course, their own culture and their own convictions. And if there are no convictions, there's no culture. So it was a very interesting debate. Now we have someone who is very, very special, who is going to start the hackathon. And why do I say he's someone very special? Because he's known as an orchestral conductor, first and foremost. He's a disciple of Leonard Bernstein, and probably to conduct the hackathon, I found out what his background is. But he graduated in philosophy, so I don't know whether he's a philosopher who became a musician, or a musician who became a philosopher, or is a philosopher. But we now have to realize that artists are always highly intelligent, and they not only artists because they couldn't do anything else, but because they chose to become artists. Itai Talgam is his name.
The board is yours.
Thank you so much.
First of all, it was a great discussion. Do you agree?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was really good. I mean, and that's not trivial. I'm not criticizing anything. I'm just telling you about my experience from last year. It was the first time I came here. I don't speak the language. I mean, French. I speak other languages. But I was hypnotized. Simply hypnotized by the French great art of rhetoric. You say rhetoric. It was so beautiful. There was the Minister of Culture was here. She spoke for 15 minutes. I felt it was like a beautiful coloratura. It was an hour long, I think. Yeah, 50 minutes. The beauty for itself, beauty for beauty's sake. Now, and I thought, Why can't I, you know, understand it? It's simply because in my profession, you may want to speak very beautifully to people, to inspire them, to lift them to higher a mode of existence, but you always are looking for a practical thing, actually. You want to change something. So it's a language of change that I want to speak about. The beautiful moments of debate here were debates over a gap, actually very polite, but a deep disagreement. And being a disciple of Leonard Bernstein, whom you all know, I'd like to tell you a little story and let you hear Bernstein speaking about it before we go to the hackathon. And now the story is like that. You've all heard about Glenn Gould, the great pianist, fantastic performer, but completely crazy. Completely. In a good way, but, you know. And then there is this evening, in Carnegie Hall, where Leonard Bernstein is supposed to be conducting the New York Philharmonic, and Glenn Gould is supposed to be the soloist playing Brahms. Now, on the evening, you know, both soloist and conductor are supposed to go on stage. Only Bernstein goes on stage. Everybody understands there's a huge problem. Something happened. And then Bernstein gives this wonderful speech about collaboration from two sides of a huge gap. And I think if we are about to collaborate in this hall and outside it, as you'll soon hear, again about the hackathon. It's worth our while to listen to that. So it's 4 minutes. It's a lot, huh? 4 minutes in English, but we'll manage, right? Okay, can we hear that? Bernstein about collaboration.
The Canadian pianist Glenn Gould is to be soloist now. Leonard Bernstein conducting the New York Philharmonic in a performance of the Piano Concerto No. 1 in D minor by Brahms. I think Mr. Bernstein will have something to say to the audience, so down to the stage.
Don't be frightened, Mr. Gould is here. Will appear in a moment. I am not, as you know, in the habit of speaking on any concert except the Thursday night previews, but a curious situation has arisen which merits, I think, a word or two. You are about to hear a rather, shall we say, unorthodox performance of the Brahms D minor concerto, a performance distinctly different from any I've ever heard, or even dreamt of, for that matter, in its remarkably broad tempi and its frequent departures from Brahms' dynamic indications. I cannot say I am in total agreement with Mr. Gould's conception. And this raises the interesting question, what am I doing conducting it? I'm conducting it because Mr. Gould is so valid and serious an artist that I must take seriously anything he conceives in good faith. And his conception is interesting enough so that I feel you should hear it too. But the age-old question still remains, in a concerto, who is the boss, the soloist, or the conductor? The answer is, of course, sometimes one and sometimes the other, depending on the people involved. But almost always, the two manage to get together by persuasion or charm or even threats to achieve a unified performance. I have only once before in my life had to submit to a soloist's wholly new and incompatible concept, and that was the last time I accompanied Mr. Gould. But this time, the discrepancies between our views are so great that I feel I must make this small disclaimer. So why, to repeat the question, am I conducting it? Why do I not make a minor scandal, get a substitute soloist, or let an assistant conduct it? Because I am fascinated, glad to have the chance for a new look at this much played work. Because, what's more, there are moments in Mr. Gould's performance that emerge with astonishing freshness and conviction. Thirdly, because we can all learn something from this extraordinary artist who is a thinking performer. And finally, because there is in music what Dimitri Mitropoulos used to call the sportive element, that factor of curiosity, adventure, experiment. And I can assure you that it has been an adventure this week, collaborating with Mr. Gould on this Brahms concerto. And it's in this spirit of adventure that we now present it to you.
I hope you feel like I do that this is an important thing to be said and listened to. Now, we said that this kind of speech is aiming to achieve something, to change something in the world. And we thought that it's completely impossible to have so many influential, not to say talented, energetic people in the form of Avignon without actually making a very clear contribution to the world. And that's why we decided to have this hackathon. I'm saying, you know, everybody involved, all the... Now, hackathon comes from the world of unconferences of high-tech. You know what unconference is? Conference is where you decide everything and you tell people come and listen to the debates, and these are, unconference is just you bring everybody in and you just order pizza and you give them pizza, and at the end of the day they come up with something. Now they couldn't do it here in France because they couldn't find a three Michelin stars chef to make the pizza. I understand that. So what we have today is a kind of a mix between, you know, wisdom of the crowds, and you are the very elite crowds we mean, and the contribution of, you know, some thinkers in the organization, outside the organization. So we have a hackathon. What does it mean? It means that we want to create projects that will go from this room outside to the world and make something we can come back in a year time and say, this is what we've done. Now, we have five groups. We can add more groups. We can add more people to the groups. So if you hear something today that catches your ear, you can find me or come to the hackathon room. You'll see some signs. Just join in. We're going to look for the participation of also students tomorrow from the university. But first of all, what are the topics we want to speak about? Now, we all just met today, or most of us just met today for the first time on the train, so I don't know by names all the people who are going to actually present. But I do know the subject. Will the five people presenting the five different hackathon groups come here? Yeah? Can you? Okay. Yeah, we'll make a little line here. Okay, you look skeptical.
I'm Pierre.
You're Pierre.
Yeah, I'm Pierre.
Hello, Pierre.
Hello.
What do you, which one are you presenting?
Alors, nous, enfin, je suis désolé d'être tout seul.
Sorry, I'm all by myself. My group is working, so I'm alone here. We're going to work on making culture. I'm an artist. I didn't introduce myself. My name is Pierre Jenner. And I know what culture is because I produced an exhibition on video games called Musical Culture, which was put on here in near me here in Marseille. It was images like birds. I know what making things is about, making digital things. I was involved in the Imaginarium in the north of France, and making culture. Here in the Avignon Forum, I'm not exactly sure what we're going to do, but we've invented a person, and I'll show you the project. We have invented a person who is a person who lives in a virtual world, and this is going to enable us to question the virtual world and to raise questions about our relationship to the digital space and the content of that digital space and what we could do in it. So our project is to listen, to speak. If I know something, and if we all know something about culture, which we do, it is something that brings us together to talk together, at least I hope. So let's have the video.
Thank you.
My name is Claudio Vandry. Where's my team? There are two of them up there. I haven't seen where the others are. Oh, they're at the back of the room there. And there's one right at the top there. So there are six of us, and we are working on transmitting writing on screens. And hackathon, we know what we want to hack, but we don't know yet what we're going to build. But we're going to try and build something between now and tomorrow. What we want to break down and rebuild is the book. We're starting from writing. A book is often considered as a finished object, a sacred object which you have to read from beginning to end. And what we want to do is to have a book which is an interface that we can interrogate to get data and get that data to interact, and a book which is also a social interface, creating a relationship between people, between places, and the content of the book. So we got together on the train, and some of you were asked to take photographs of the books you were leaving. So if you have the photographs, you can produce them in the tweet on the hashtag that I gave you, and we'll show you what we've come up with tomorrow afternoon, considering the book as an interface and not a finished object. That's basically what we're about.
Bonjour à tous.
Good afternoon to everyone. Our team is around the table here: Nicolas Gaume, Camille Cobrière, Elisa Dumer, and myself, Léo Caillard. And what we're going to try and do is to answer the question, prescribe culture, curate data, which is a real job at the time of big data and everyone's tastes, which are different. So I'm going to give the floor to Camille, who started with her colleague the Guest Views project, which we're going to be working on tomorrow. She is collecting the information on visitors to cultural institutions, and she will say a little more about what her project is all about. Good evening to everyone. Prescribing culture, curating culture, this is a new endeavor. There are different contents, different types of content, and curators are changing. The social networks are taking a big role, and big data is among us. We're not afraid of big data. How do we use big data in an experiment over 24 hours? And we have photographs, questionnaires to try and find out your tastes. So you have 24 hours to participate. Please give us as much data as you possibly can about you, about your tastes, and we shall present the results tomorrow tomorrow afternoon. Thank you.
Just
for your information, this is in the panetry room. We have our stand there. No, it will be in La Panetterie, which is just next door. So please come by and help us. We need participation. We need your information, as much information as you can provide us with. So please give us that information. Come by and see us.
Bonsoir, je suis Laurence.
My name is Laurence Aubry, and I'm part of the group which is going to be involved in research engines at the Service of Cultural Diversity. Our investigation will be much wider than simply research engines, because our question is going to be what has happened since the digital era of culture started. How have we shifted from an analog world in which we had a small number of people who knew and organized on a top-down basis the access to culture, and they controlled most of the communication tools in a pretty monopolistic way? How have we shifted from that to a far more open universe in which our cultural experience cultural discoveries of new cultures, new cultural practices, are entirely or almost determined by the economy of recommendation, by recommendations from our friends, by recommendations we receive from our peers, as well as by recommendations from people in the know and from the media. So we are looking at a very different type of media, and we're going to ask how it all works. As this is a hackathon, what we're going to do is to try and hack the codes and rewrite the codes. The American legal experts say that the code is the law. Well, we shall try and see if we can reinvent and rewrite little bits of law for the digital world, for public cultural institutions, but also for all of us who are cultural players, taking into account the fact that access to culture, once again, is no longer simply what we know, read, and view because we are told to, but which is organized in a very much more democratic, wide-ranging way with far more players involved. And we should also, I think, have the opportunity, because we consider that the research engine is absolutely central to all this. That was where it all started. We also will have the opportunity of having a great demonstrator, which is called LT Media, which is a research engine which shows how, in real time, we see subjects coming to the fore, cultural subjects, cultures, subjects about the media, how they stand out or don't stand out, and how can they influence the cultural debate. So please come by and see what we're doing tomorrow.
You understand that we can't really talk about hackathon is one thing. We all have different understandings of what is a project that can go out to the world and make a difference. But we'll see. We simply have to conduct a good conversation. Yeah? With everybody. Everybody is really invited to chip in. And really, the success of a hackathon will be if it becomes viral. And, you know, I've met so many people here that I could tell myself, you know, if I only did a project with that lady, it would be fantastic, or that person here, it would be great for my career. This is not about our careers. This is about being able to come together and give something to the world. And I hope you like the idea. Now, just to send you to the culinary, highlight of the day, with a little bit of music, I'd like to come back to Bernstein and to a piece of a video clip, which, you know, speaking about visuals versus written things. And, I mean, if we hadn't had video, it would be such a waste. Just look at this 3 minutes of finale of Haydn and see how far you can go with a dialogue without words, putting aside the beauty of talking about it and just doing something, okay? So this is our call to you. Let's do something. I hope you enjoy the music, and we'll see you at dinner.
Music.
Now with the visuals, it's all about the visuals. Okay? Can we hear it? And he says, wait a minute, it'll be okay. For now we can sing something together. Shall we? Let's go. Thank you. I just want to say it's great that you like it. It takes some effort to get there, okay? You don't start this way. But once you do everything, you know, right, and this comes, then it's such a pleasure. Let's make the effort. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Hello.
Itai, merci. Itai, thank you very much indeed. Well done. I mean, we'd have liked for it to have gone on a bit longer, but there's something else that you're expecting. But before I talk about what you're expecting now, let me talk about tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning, please, I'd like you to be here so that we can start at 8:30. We shall start very precisely in this room at 8:45. So please make an effort to be here at 8:30. At 10 o'clock this evening, 10 p.m., you have a concert given for the people, the good people of Avignon, because talking about culture in a city of culture, obviously one has to be inclusive of the people who live here. So at 10 p.m. at the Opéra Théâtre, the group Nouvelle Vague. And final point, you will, I think, be having a few sandwiches for your dinner. But because it's cold and because we don't want to lose you, please go through the inside of the Palais des Papes. You won't see it from the outside, but you will be able to see it from the outside tomorrow evening at 8:30 and at 10:30. The Palais des Papes will be specially lit. It's not exactly the right word, but for the participants of the forum, there will be a lighting show on the facade of the Palais des Papes at 8:20 p.m. and 10:20 p.m. tomorrow evening. So please follow the hostesses who will guide you through the Palais des Papes like their predecessors would have done a few centuries ago, when the cardinals who had elected their pope went to dinner through the kitchen. So have a good dinner. See you tomorrow. You treat me